J.P. Moreland is a distinguished professor of philosophy at the Talbot School of Theology at Biola University. He was judged by an expert panel to be one of the top 50 philosophers on the planet. One of the top 50 philosophers on the planet. Notice we didn't qualify that by saying Christian. He's one of the top 50 philosophers on the planet. And here he is in Henderson, Nevada, for goodness sake. Yeah. Woo. And he's not afraid to drink out of a styrofoam cup. You're here a few Sundays ago. I said, you are a free people because you can drink out of styrofoam cups. In California, you know, we get arrested for such things. But J.P. Moreland has some introductory remarks, and I think you're going to really find he's good. Get something to write with, something to write on, because you're going to need it. Dr. J.P. Moreland.
Thank you, Craig. Well, thank you, my dear brother. Craig and I have worked together for so long, and we have such a love for each other, and it's great to be here. We enjoy these conferences so much. You might want to take notes on this one, because there's going to be a fair amount shared. Several years ago, I did a conference up in Seattle, and I was flying home Sunday morning. And while I was waiting for my flight, I got a copy of the Seattle Times, which is not an evangelical newspaper. And there on the front page, spilling over half into the second page, this was a page and a half editorial. That's a big editorial. The title was A Divided Nation. And the author went on to say that we now live in the most divided time in American history since the Civil War. I actually think that things have become more divided since that article was written. So that I don't think is disputable. But what fascinated me about the article was what he said was at the very bottom of our divisions. He said it is not race. It is not politics. Now think about that. He's saying that political division is not our fundamental division. It's not socioeconomic. It's not gender or sexuality. Now, these are big divisions, folks. He said the number one division among the American people is a division of worldview. Worldview. Now, a worldview is just the sum total of what you believe about life's most important questions. It's the sum total of what you believe about life's most important questions. Atheism is a worldview. Lesbianism is a worldview. Communism. Christianity is a worldview. Because this comprises a set of what a person believes about the most important questions of life. And he said that there were two dominant worldviews. He was wrong about that. He was a political scientist, so he can be forgiven when he was speaking about philosophy. I'll give you the three worldviews that are dominant here in just a minute. But he went on to say that these other divisions, not entirely, but are significantly flowing out of different views of the world. And if we're going to solve these problems, we can't simply address them at the level of race or economics. We're going to have to get down at the level of worldview and root things out at that level. Now, I will tell you the three worldviews in a minute and begin to give you some things that will help in this discussion. But we now live at a time when not only are we considered to be ignorant and backward and stupid for believing in a myth like the resurrection of Jesus, which is comparable to believing in the flying spaghetti monster, but that's a frequent atheist analogy. Of course, you don't find 1.5 billion people that are willing to die and give their lives for a flying spaghetti monster. So there's probably a difference between the two, but we'll leave that for a little bit later. But we now live in a time also when the ethics of Jesus are considered immoral. And so not only is it stupid to believe in Jesus Christ, but if you do, you are a bigot and you're a part of the moral problem that is like a cancer killing this country. It's Christian morality. Let me give you an example of two people that said this. This was from novelist Jane Smiley, who said about us, now here's how their ignorance works. First, they put the fear of God into you. If you don't believe in the literal word of the Bible, you'll burn in hell. Of course, the literal word of the Bible is tremendously contradictory. And so you have to abdicate all critical thinking. That's why I got a PhD in philosophy. And accept a simple but logical system of belief that is dangerous to question. So there are no questions, please. Don't ask any questions here. A corollary to this point is we make sure you understand that Satan resides in the toils and snares of complex thought. So it's best not to think at all. So apparently we're a people that are deeply against thinking, because that's from the devil. Instead, we believe in faith, which is not true. Here's a statement from a good while ago by Robert Reich, who was the Secretary of Labor, a professor at Harvard, still active on talk shows. I want you to listen to what he said in an online journal, because this is really shocking. He says, the great conflict of the 21st century will not be between the West and terrorism. Now, that surprises me. That's a pretty big conflict. No. Terrorism is a tactic, but it is not a belief. The true battle of the 21st century is going to be between modern civilization and anti-modernists, between those who believe in the primacy of the individual and those who believe that human beings owe their allegiance to a higher power, between those who give priority to this life in this world and those who believe that human life is a mere preparation for life beyond the grave, between those who believe in science, reason, and logic, and those who believe the truth is revealed through scripture and religious dogma. Terrorism will disrupt and destroy our lives, but terrorism itself is not the greatest danger we face. Fundamentalist Christians are. Now, you have to understand that that is held by approximately 28% of the secular progressive elite in this country. They are deeply entrenched in the centers of power. As Nietzsche predicted, they dominate the university. They dominate the media. Studies have been shown that a good percentage of the media are agnostic or atheist. I think it's something like 80%. And they dominate the entertainment industry. So the power sources hold that we are part of the problem. And I'll mention a clear example of this tomorrow that I think you'll be able to relate to. Now, why do we care about this? Well, it's because there are three worldviews that are fighting for the hearts and minds of our neighbors and our kids and each other. One of them is Christianity, and we'll say a little bit more about that tomorrow, but I'm glad to say that Christianity is still a major player in the thinking of Americans. So that's one worldview. The second worldview is by far the dominant, most powerful worldview in Western culture, including the United States, because we're going to be in it, we're moving toward Europe. And it is scientific naturalism. Scientific naturalism is the idea that the only way that you can know anything is through the hard sciences. So if you can prove something with chemistry and physics and biology, you can know it. But if you can't prove something through the hard sciences, like in ethics or certain areas of theology or the humanities, you can't know anything. Nobody knows who's right. So that's why Oprah Winfrey feels free to get on television and pontificate, which she's done several times, about God, whoever she is. Because if she was going to speak on smallpox or AIDS, what would she do? She'd bring on a what? An expert or an authority. What's an expert? Somebody who knows more than other people about the subject. But there's no knowledge outside of science. So there's no knowledge in theology and ethics. Are you following me? So theology and ethics are reduced to feelings and faith. And Oprah is admittedly an expert on her feelings. And so that's why she would have the gall to do something and not bat an eye about it. Because she wasn't thinking she was doing anything odd, talking about a subject for which she had no training. Because there you can't be training in theology and ethics, because it's a field that can't be proven one way or the other. Nobody knows right and wrong, because it can't be scientifically tested. Now that ends up meaning then that the physical universe is all there is. There's no world outside the physical universe. There's no soul. Your brain and central nervous system. Your brain contains your memories, not your soul. It's nonsense. That's not true. Your brain contains electrolyzed meat, and that's it. Your memories are not in your brain. So let's get that straight. I spoke to one of the leading experts in the world on memory, a professor at UC Santa Barbara, and he came and gave a lecture at Biola, and he said, I have no idea what it even means to say memories are in a brain. What does that even mean? Because memories are not spatially extended. A memory doesn't have a left half and a right half. It doesn't have geometrical properties. My memory of my grandmother isn't 2 inches long and shaped like an ellipsis and closer to my left ear than my right ear. Everything in my brain has spatial extension. The neurons, the different portions of the brain, the atoms and the electrons. So here's the argument. Everything in my brain has spatial extension. Memories don't have spatial extension. Therefore, memories aren't in your brain. Plus, in near-death experiences, which have happened to 14 million Americans and 300 people worldwide, these are real. People take their memories with them while their brain is dead. You don't need a memory to think or eyeballs to see, except while you're embodied. That's it. The brain is a nice electrolyzed piece of meat. And the brain uses it, and the mind uses it. If it's broken, the mind can't work, just like your eyeballs. But it's nothing more than that. Sorry, I'm getting off on a tangent. Now, so naturalism, the physical world is all there is. The only thing you can know is through the sciences. The final worldview is postmodern relativism, which says that there is no such thing as knowledge. There's no truth, there's no reality, there's no knowledge. There's only what's true for a certain group, what's real for a certain group, and what's what can be known for a certain group. But that might be false and unknown to another group, and nobody's wrong. Truth, reality, and knowledge are relative to the group. Now, these two other worldviews, postmodernism and scientific naturalism, don't agree about a lot of things, but there's one thing they agree on that I want you to take away knowing this when you go home, and here it is. Both worldviews agree that there is no such thing as knowledge outside the hard sciences. They both agree with that. Now, what that means is religion is not a field of knowledge. You can't know anything in religion or ethics. All right, now why does that matter? Because people are given authority in our culture based on the knowledge they have. We give lawyers the authority to do certain things because we assume they have a certain range of knowledge. I give a mechanic the right to do certain things to my car because I presuppose that he has a certain knowledge of how a car functions. I have a neighbor and he likes me, but I will never let him touch my teeth. I have a dentist who I'm not sure he likes me, hurts me. But if he came up to me and said, I got to be honest with you, I don't really know a lot about teeth, but I have a lot of deeply held, passionate beliefs and feelings about them. He's not getting anywhere near me. If I thought my pastor just had a bunch of deeply held beliefs and feelings, I'm going to quit the church and become a bartender. Heck, I'll be a womanizing bartender. That's a lot more fun than going to a church where nobody knows anything. So the point is that if you want to marginalize Christianity, you have to represent it as a realm of life for which no one knows anything one way or the other. We don't know if there's a God. We don't know if there's not a God. We don't know if one religion is true or if they're all not true. We don't know what is right and what is wrong. It's a social creation relative to your culture. Now, do you see if that's true? You have now cut the knees out from underneath Christianity. You see that? Because we can't speak with authority. Nobody asks pastors to speak with authority about anything. They ask them to provide comfort, but they don't ask them to speak with authority. So when Columbine happened years ago, youth ministers were not brought on stage in the national media to ask what's going on with our youth. It was neuroscientists, social psychologists, and so on. Pastors were there to comfort the family, but not to make comments about what was happening because they don't know anything. They don't know a thing. They have a set of personal little beliefs and feelings. Okay, you with me? Now, I am convinced that you can know there's a God, you can know Jesus rose from the dead, and that you know these things. You don't just know them, but that you know them. Now, in order for me to be clear on this, I'm going to have to take the time I have left, and I want to define truth and knowledge for you, and if I get a chance, I'd like to define faith. So let's jump into this. What is truth? Here's a definition of truth. Truth is a matching between a thought or a belief and reality. Truth is a matching between a thought and a belief and reality. Instead of matching, you could just say a correspondence. So if I have a thought that 2 and 2 is 4, and 2 and 2 really is 4, there is a match between those two. Do you understand that? And that match is truth. Okay? You can have truth without knowing you have truth. Before we went to the moon, somebody could have made a wild guess what was on the backside of the moon, and if that's the way the backside of the moon was, his belief was true because it matched reality, but he had no clue if it was right or not. Does that make sense? That's a matter of knowing, okay? So truth is like larger than. You can't have larger than unless you got two things. So one's larger than the other one. Right? Make sense? You couldn't have larger than with only one object in the room. You got to have two. Well, truth can't take place unless you got two things. Just like larger than. One of them is reality, and two is a thought or a belief or an assertion. So truth happens when an assertion or a thought or a belief about reality matches the way reality really is. Now, you might say, well, that's just your definition of truth. Well, let me give you an example. If somebody says, well, that's your definition of truth, what you want to do is give them a simple example. So I call this the bookstore example. I'm at the bookstore, and I'm in my office at the university, and the bookstore calls me and says, Prof. Moreland, The book by Richard Swinburne called The Existence of God that you ordered. It came in today. You can come and pick it up. Now, I don't trust the people in the bookstore because they've tricked me to get me over there before. And so I don't know what to make of it. But for the first time all day, I've got a thought in my mind. And what's that thought? Richard Swinburne's book, The Existence of God, is in the bookstore. So I go over to see if it is true. Now I start walking with my dear colleague, Dr. Horner. And he doesn't know why I'm going to the bookstore. We're chatting and talking, and we're all over the map. And he's got a great Jimmy Stewart imitation, and so he's doing that. He's also got a dysfunctional Santa Claus thing, and he does his dysfunctional Santa Claus. The guy's funny. And so we're talking, and we both go in the bookstore, and he doesn't know why I'm going there. And at the same time, our eyes fall on Richard Swinburne's book, The Existence of God. Would you agree that we have an experience in common at that moment? What is that experience? We both saw the book. Did that involve our senses? Yes. So we both saw the book. But I had a second experience he didn't have. Because I not only saw the book, but I became aware that my thought about the book is true. Why didn't he have that? Because he didn't have what? He did not have the relevant thought. Now, could he have had that? Yeah, all he had to do was to say, well, the book is in the bookstore, and that assertion would correspond with reality, and he'd have truth, would he not? But he failed to have the thought, so he saw the book, but he didn't experience truth. Now, what was it that I experienced when I experienced truth? It was not the book, and it was not my thought. It was the matching between the two of them. Does that make sense to you? By the way, you cannot see, touch, taste, smell, or hear truth. In the example I gave you, you can see the book. You can't see your thought about the book. And you can't see the matching relationship between the two, but you can be aware of it, which proves that we're able to be aware of things that go beyond our senses. More about that in a minute. Now, my wife says, you're angry. No, I'm not angry. Yes, you are. So I form the thought I'm angry, and I don't go to the bookstore. I go inside and bump up against this seething anger. I compare my thought with what's going on inside of me, and I notice that matching deal, and I think, what's that matching thing again? Oh, yeah, truth. If it didn't match, what would that be? Falsehood. Falsehood. When we say somebody's a false prophet, we say that their assertions do not match reality. When we say thy word is truth, we mean properly interpreted, whatever it teaches to be true is matching reality. Okay, are you clear about that? Now, what is knowledge? There are three kinds of knowledge. The first is knowledge by direct experience. So right now, I'm having knowledge by direct experience with this sister's face and with this gentleman's face here, the lights. I'm having knowledge by direct experience, okay? You don't need to be able to think or have concepts in your mind to have this kind of knowledge. In fact, a little child can have knowledge by a direct experience of an apple without knowing that it is an apple. In fact, it's only after repeated experiences of the apple and hearing mom use the word apple that they begin to associate the word with the apple, and they can form a concept of an apple and think about an apple when none is there. So experience comes first. Now, the important thing for you to know is that direct experience is not limited to your five senses. For example, you can have direct awareness of what's going on in your conscious life by just introspecting. And when you introspect, you become aware of, say, sensations, maybe of pain or of hunger. You might become aware of a desire for ice cream. You might bump up against what you're thinking about, or a belief that you have about the Second World War, or what is it, whatever. There you become acquainted or aware of what's happening inside of you, but you can't see, touch, taste, smell, or hear it. Mathematics and logic are known by direct awareness. You don't do a proof in logic and math by using the empirical method that science uses. You don't know that a mathematical proof is true by your senses. You know it by just being aware, aha, this follows from this. Does that make sense? That's by intuitive knowledge. Now, Christianity provides this kind of knowledge because we can be aware of God. There have been times in my life where he has actually showed up in worship, in prayer. There are times when he is disgustingly absent. But he has made himself detectable to me. Anybody else had that experience? That is knowledge by acquaintance. I have been aware of demons. I can't go into great detail, but there's no question that there were demons that came in this gymnasium. And I was at mid-court and became aware of them, and it was three guys that came in, and I watched where they sat and went and talked to them after a Christian talk was given, and they were sure enough involved in the occult, and they were there to curse the meeting. And I sensed the demonic presence come in that room when I wasn't even looking over there. I know people, and I could tell you an angel story about me that would make the hair stand up on the back of your neck. But it is beyond reasonable doubt that there are three angels standing with me now, a tall one behind me and one on either side. And this is beyond reasonable doubt. The evidence I have for this is overwhelmingly empirical evidence. I'll give it to you tomorrow, because I know you want to hear about it, but I'm not going to do it tonight. I can't, because I've got to be finished here. But people can be aware of angels. People can be aware. Has anybody in here ever been aware of a demonic presence? Okay. Has anybody ever been aware of an angel or seen an angel? Listen, okay, a ton of you. That is knowledge. That's not a subjective experience. Oh, religion's just a bunch of subjective experiences. You're an idiot if you say that. This is knowledge of objective reality. There are too many people that have knowledge of acquaintance with angels and demons for it to all be wrong. This is a form of knowledge. Are you there? There's a second kind of knowledge called propositional knowledge. Propositional knowledge. This is a true belief based on adequate reasons. It is a true belief based on adequate reasons. I know there are more than five people in this room. And that is a true belief. That means it matches reality, right? It's true. It's a belief. That means I accept it to be true. And I don't just blindly accept it to be true, but I've got adequate reasons for believing there are at least 15 people in this room. That means I know that there are 15 people in this room. Now, let me illustrate it. Out where I live, there's a place called Newport Beach, and there's a public men's restroom there. Suppose that there was a drunk man that drank 24/7, and he hung around the men's room. And he had formed the habit of believing everything written on the second stall of the men's room. His motto was, "The stall says it, I believe it, that settles it." So he goes in one day, and on the stall, George Washington was the first president of the United States. Now, he has never heard of what a president is. He doesn't know what a president is. He's never heard the name George Washington. So he can hardly make sense of it. But he says, doggone it, the stall says it, and I believe it. Now, compare him with a historian who, through a ton of research, through newspaper articles and congressional records, has a true belief that George Washington was the first president of the United States. Now, the historian knows this, but our Newport Beach gentleman does not know it. But they do have two things in common. Are you still with me? They both have the truth, right? They both believe the truth, so they both have true beliefs, right? But one has knowledge that these are true beliefs because his true belief is based on adequate evidence. The other guy's lucky. He's lucky. So when you teach people why they believe what they believe, you turn a true belief into knowledge. Now listen carefully. You can know something without being certain you're right. Knowledge does not require certainty. The only person in the history of Western thought that believed that was Descartes, and he messed us up. Nobody since Aristotle has believed that knowledge requires certainty. Notice I did not say knowledge is a true belief based on certifying evidence. I said based on adequate evidence. What's adequate evidence? There's no general answer. You have to look at the field of study and decide what it would be in music or history or religion or ethics or chemistry. It's going to be different. But you can know that God exists, stay with me, but still admit you might be mistaken, though you don't have any good reason to think you are, but you now I could be wrong on this, but I know God exists. And I've got questions and doubts, but I still know God exists. That means that if you have doubts about it and questions, and you admit you might be mistaken, that doesn't mean you don't know that God exists. You know that God exists if you have a true belief that's based on good, solid reasons. And we're going to give you some of those this weekend. Are you there? So when I claim that we know that there's a God, I mean, first of all, we can be directly aware of him from time to time. Number two, we have a true belief that God is real and the resurrection happened and so on, based on good, solid reasons. And the third kind of knowledge is what's called know-how or skill. Know-how or skill. And that's the ability to do something well. So my dad was a welder, and he could fix anything. And he had know-how or skill. Some people just call it savvy. I think the Bible calls it wisdom. And he could tell what was wrong with a car, but he couldn't tell me how he knew what was wrong with a car. He could just see it and fix it. I said, how in the heck did you know that? I said, I don't know how I knew it. I could just see it. Look at it. I'm looking at the thing, and I have no clue. You've met people like that. You know what? The Bible gives us a ton of wisdom and know-how. You want to know what love is? Don't ask those nuts. You go to 1 Corinthians 13, and you know that that's the skill for love because you ask yourself, would I like to marry somebody like that or have a mom and dad like that? And it doesn't take a rocket scientist to go, you bet, because that's love. The Bible gives us wisdom about prayer and all kinds of things. So I will close in a second, but when I claim that we can know things in Christianity, number one, I claim that we can sometimes be aware of these things directly. Secondly, that we have a true belief about a number of the things Christianity teaches that is based on really good, solid, adequate reasons. And finally, we have wisdom and skill for how to live well that comes to us from the Scriptures. Are you in agreement with that? Now, you don't have to be certain to have knowledge. You just have to have good, solid, adequate reasons. Now, I close with faith. Today, faith means, as Craig pointed out, it's just the choice to believe something blindly without any evidence one way or the other. But that's not a biblical definition of faith. For the Bible, faith is trusting something based on your knowledge or evidence about that thing. It's trusting or having confidence in something based on what you know about it or based on what you have reason to believe about it. So the more you know about a car, if it's a good car, the more you can put what? Trust in that car, isn't that right? So reason actually strengthens faith. It's not the more knowledge you got, the less faith you can have. No, knowledge can give you stronger faith. And tomorrow we're going to look at some of the reasons how we can know God exists. Thank you.